Hey guys, what it is? It is your girl Cadillac. Yes, I'm Cadillac Dixon. I'm the drama life prison wife. I'm the legally blind artist that is rapping and painting for justice. Hoping, girl. Because I got to hold my breath to see justice before it all fades to black. Yes, it's your girl Cadillac. Anyways, coming through on March the 22nd. Today was everything. Today was good. And today was, okay, so first of all, I had, I don't know, it looks like some dry skin on my nose. I'm sorry, guys. I have eczema. And it's always some on my face when I start recording. Even though I lotion up, put on my little lip chapstick, girl, it's still all going to bed once I get on this camera. But today we just going to keep it moving. I had a decent day at work. Girl, if you seen all these notes, I got four. Let me show y'all. Look at all these notes. This is tonight's video. Yes. And it started out on this. Like, I had a good long shift. Just notes on top of notes. On top of notes, girl. So, that's what we're going to go through in just a few moments. So, for me, work was profitable. Because I was able to go to work. I guess I got paid for that, you know, for trading my life for some dollars, right? That's what work really is. Trading your life for some dollars and then taking the dollars and trading it back to pay some bills. So you don't even get paid, right? Bills get paid. But when I can spend that much time sitting and just meditating on a situation and coming up with so many notes, it just starts flowing whenever I can get into that mode. This so reminds me of when I worked at Walmart and I used to come home with these same type of receipt papers, but at that time they would have all types of poems and raps because I was a rapper trying to break the story of my husband case, and I would come home with tons of songs a day basically. And then I would sit also at the door. I love to be the door greeter, except for when I got sleepy, girl, because I would have that little notebook. And that, you know, when you go out that door, if someone go out the door and it makes the alarm go off, we had to record it, like write it in the notebook of what was going on. So I would just keep that binder in my hand, and girl, I'd be sketching. Matter of fact, that Hold You Down video that I showed at the last of my live, at the end of my live last night, I drew that while I was door greeting. And then in 2020, when the world shut down, I basically remixed and mastered that and did every frame in Photoshop and made it almost immaculate. Crazy. I stayed up to 4:30 in the morning on a live with you guys. If you would, please go check out that live because I spent a lot of time recording it. I basically was going through the alleged crime scene. Y'all know I'm basically, I started on this route. I started the whole channel for this purpose, but people, you know, clearly were showing me that they weren't there for that. And no matter how much I want this channel to break my husband's case, that's not what people want from me. So I kind of eased off of it, went into vlogging and some artwork, but still not really tackling the issues that I want. Like, I don't know, there really is no place for justice, it seems like. There is no place. People always, oh, well, this is not the place for that because people come here for entertainment, or that's not the place for that because people, where's the place for justice? Because it is not the courthouse. Like, they withholding justice there. So where, I don't know, it's crazy. So I kind of backed off of it until I came across the C murder, aka, girl, I did it again. Corey Miller, aka C Murder case, and he's on a hunger strike. I gotta get updates on that. Like, how did that play out? Did he get any traction? What's going on, girl? Hopefully he did. I tried the best on my channel to bring attention to this story. We need criminal justice reform now. Like, we needed it a whole long a time ago. Like, for real, the system is only getting worse as we speak. And it needs to be redone, all like completely redone. It's eating too many people alive, and it's majority of our people that are getting eaten alive through this system, right? And I'm tired of feeding our men to this system, right? And to be honest, education, prevention, all of those things are greater than incarceration. Let's educate our Black men or Black boys. Let's prevent them from going to the street. What leads them to the street? Okay, how can we fix these issues or attempt to fix them, attempt to address them? One issue, I believe, is because a lot of people, a lot of this generation just don't have their fathers in the house. And a father, girl, I done learned so much from my father. So, and oh, just getting on that, before I left work, a coworker of mine, father passed away. God, that was crazy. Let's give a moment of silence. Girl, I know that pain. I know that pain. My mother was here and then she wasn't. And I always used to think if I could just skip that one day, if I could skip that one day in time, she would still be here. So in my mind, I would act like that day did not happen and that she's still here. But, you know, she's just not here, but she's here, you know. But, whew, Lord be with us. Okay, so anyways, I want money to have her father and have her father free. Our daughter went through so much just by her father being incarcerated and her longing for her father and just wanting her father and her father to pick her up. I'm gonna tell you, we would always take our visitation pictures, and money had got so big. Money was tall for her age and her legs were so long. And I had this one friend, associate, that would, every time I would come back from visitation, she'd be like, let me see that old visitation picture. Did he pick that girl up? And I was like, yeah, he picked her up. No matter how big money got, Marcello was still struggling. Marcello is little. Marcello's skinny, a little slim guy. But he struggled to pick that girl. If he could pick her up now, I tell y'all, Marcello would pick her up if he could. And just to see, like, when we were visiting him at a place called Lake, like, that's when she was about 10 years old. And they would have this field out there where he can just go out there and play with her, would pick her up, swing her around. And she was just so overjoyed to actually have these moments with her father. Okay, so let's get into these notes because I ain't gonna have no whole long time. And it probably is about time for Mr. Jackson to call. So if this phone vibrates, hold on, don't tell me I'd already missed this call. Because my ringer broke. What ain't broke on my phone? My iPhone 6. I think I already missed this call. But he gonna call back. Oh no, I didn't miss it yet. Okay, so they're probably in count. We're in different time zones. My husband is almost 7 hours away from the house. They got him, I'm in Florida. They got him way up there on the Florida, Georgia, Alabama border. So he's very far from home. It's very hard to go see him. And your girl broke, so I don't think we'll be seeing him no time soon. But yeah, so they are probably in count now. Okay, so let's start with the notes. I'm going to attempt to read them. Girl, y'all know I write it in this permanent marker because that's what we have. That's what we have there, right? But then I also have very bad handwriting. Okay, so this is continuing on with the grave mistakes we make when we take a conviction at face value. And this is going to be part 6. Okay. So let's read. Sorry. Now that I have explained many ways the arresting officer in my husband's case, see, now I can't even read that, immensely and effectively affected the case and substantially reduced the chance of my husband getting a fair trial by basically making himself an eyewitness to my husband being at the club in the parking lot, where he would have, in fact, had to have been to commit the alleged robbery / carjacking. What better witness for the state than an officer? An officer who sworn and vowed to uphold the law, defend the law, not break the law or bend and shape the law, not use the law for their own agenda. Someone sworn to protect the citizens of the city of Orlando, all citizens, not just select citizens. Okay. He also swore to protect Marcello as well, because Marcello was a citizen of the city of Florida. Not to lie on, not to falsify documents against, and etc. So I ask, did he do his job of protecting and serving? And with his actions being known, who did he protect and serve? Who was he protecting? Did the arresting officer's actions and testimony in fact affect the way the jury would view Marcello? I'm going to go back and possibly answer these questions because these are some good questions, girl. Did it have any effect on the jury's final decision? How much weight do you think? Okay. The officer's words held. Did his affidavit / testimony outweigh the evidence? Or in Marcello's case, the lack of evidence? Now, let's say the police did things the way they should have. And this is what I spent a long time. I wrote out what should have happened in that night in question, the way that everybody should have played this out. And I'm still writing it, but I think it sounds really good. Okay, let's say the police did things the way they should have been done, meaning the police cruiser testified that he was coming down Westmoreland. Now, y'all seen, I showed y'all that scene of the crime and all of that last night. If not, please check out that live in the description box below. It shows you everything. And once you see that, it really makes the police testimony disbelievable. Okay, he was coming down Westmoreland when he observed the suspect's car roll the stop sign on Federal and Westmoreland. He and another officer put on their lights and sirens and proceeded to pull the vehicle. To the officers, the suspect car, to the officer's surprise, the suspect's car didn't pull over. In fact, the car sped up. Remember, I told you Marcello just jumped up in that car to receive a ride from his cousin, and he picked him up so close to the stop sign that he ran the stop sign. And the logical thing that you would think somebody's going to do is pull the heck over when the police behind them. But no, his cousin floors it and leads the cops on a short high-speed chase through the neighborhood. So now I'm trying to put these in order, girl. Okay, number one. Okay, there we go. With intentions on evading them. So he tried to pull over the car. He didn't know that they had intentions on evading them. The suspect turns left down the street and goes around the block, and the suspect's car makes another two turns. Now, this is the real path that it traveled. Y'all know the arresting officer changed the scene of the crime. Okay, around the block, and the suspect's car makes another two turns and heads straight down a dead-end road, where one suspect jumps out the car and leaves running on foot. Okay, now I'm saying this as though I'm that arresting officer. That's how I'm reading this. We pursued that suspect and caught him. Remember how they said the suspect jumped out the car and ran? If they were playing this case out the way they should have and been truthful and honest and upholding the law, they would have told the truth. Okay, we pursued that suspect and caught him. Three other males stepped out the vehicle. Two white males and one black male. The suspect we caught is racially ambiguous. It's hard to tell his actual nationality. If we had to guess, we would say he was probably a Hispanic male. We told them to all step out the car with their hands up. We questioned all three of them about why the vehicle was attempting to evade us. And who is the driver? Why were they with him? Do they know why he would evade and then run? Do any of y'all have anything to hide? What exactly was going on? So now I'm saying it as though he's questioning all three of them. Why are you, when the car stopped, the two guys said, hey, we were robbed. And it's like they just took that and said, oh, okay, y'all were robbed now, and then just let everything else go. No, all three of them, all four of them should have been suspects. Okay, not just Marcello. Okay. And then ran. Do any of y'all have anything to hide? What exactly was going on? The two white passengers proceeded to say that the black passenger sitting on the ground, because remember I told you the lady cop made Marcello sit on the ground, carjacked them and forced them to get in the back of their vehicle. And then he proceeded to attempt to rob them. So was this other guy also attempting to rob y'all? The driver, the one that ran away? I would have asked that. Was he also trying to attempt to rob y'all? Where were you all coming from? Okay, y'all said the black guy attempted to rob y'all. Rob one of y'all or both of y'all? How much did he get from y'all? The two white suspects alleged they were robbed of $80, but just the black guy and not the racially ambiguous guy. My partner and I also questioned the other two suspects, the two white guys. They should have been suspects as well. I'm just using race because that's what they used in this case, race all day long. Okay, you were the driver of the vehicle. The other two So now he's questioning the cousin that they claim got away that really didn't get away, but they got to protect him. So they're making up all this stuff to cover him. Okay, so now I'm playing out if he had done this the correct way with him. Okay, we question the racially ambiguous guy. You were the driver of the vehicle. Why, when we tried to pull your car after we witnessed you roll the stop sign, why did you evade us? Do you have something to hide? What do you have in the car? Is there something in the car you didn't want us to see? Do you have any priors? Because he had that long rap sheet and before and after. Marcello had no priors, girl. Okay, why you the only one to run? He the only one jumped out the car and run. What were you guys up to? Why are you driving this guy's car? Because it's the other guy's car, right? Now, the reason he was driving the car is because he's taking them in the hood, like I said, to go get right. Two clean cut white guys just randomly going into this hood that sticks out. Like, they would stick out in that hood. I'm just being honest. So he's driving them in there to go get right. On the way to taking them in the hood, hey, there go my cousin Marcello. Cello, you want to ride, bruh? Gets in the car and his life is gone forever. Okay. Why were you driving this guy's car? Were you coming from where? Oh, where are you coming from? And where are you heading in such a hurry? We then questioned a black guy. We asked him, where are they going? Where were they going? He said, I don't know where my cousin and the two white guys were going. Cousin? So the driver is your cousin? Do y'all know that question came up to the jury? The jury, before making their final verdict, once trial was over, said they had a question and said one of their questions was, did anybody know that the suspect they got away and that Marcello were cousins? And the judge said, I'm not going to answer that because that's something y'all should have asked during trial. So for some reason, they wanted to know, did anybody know they were cousins? Would that have affected their verdict? They said you robbed them of $80. Did you rob them? Me and my two other officers did a search of all four suspects, not just Marcello. First, the white suspects, the first white suspect has a wallet on him. Because remember, I told you the first suspect, it was never proven. He had his own wallet. How did he get it back if Marcello had both of their wallets? Rumbling through it, didn't find money, demanding more money. So how did he miraculously get his wallet back? The second white suspect wallet was not on his person. I observed it on the front passenger floorboard of the vehicle. I write the wallet in as exhibit number, blah, blah, blah. Since they said Marcello had their wallets and was touching it, going through it and everything, that those wallets should have been dusted for fingerprints. And in trial, they asked them, why didn't they dust them? Why did you decide not to dust it? They had some random answer. I got to go back through that transcript and see what their crazy answer was. But if that solidifies that Marcello stole these wallets and robbed these people, why would you not dust it? That needs to be taken into evidence. They didn't do that. Because we need to dust it for fingerprints, since they allege the black suspect had their wallets. We searched the black suspect. We found $60 on him. We asked, where did he get the $60? And did he rob the two white suspects for it? He answers, no, he had just gotten paid. We asked the black suspect again, where were they going? The black suspect answers, I just left the 7-Eleven on Westmoreland walking. Where were you heading? The black suspect said he was headed back to his cousin's house. We asked to the cousin who ran. He answered, no, it's a female cousin's house. So were all of you headed to this female cousin's house? He said, no. His cousin was going to drop him to the female cousin's house. And then he said that they had other plans. We asked the black suspect if they always fled the authorities like that. He answered, no, I didn't know what was going on until his cousin floors it and leads the cops on a high-speed chase, and then jumps out the car. We asked the black suspect if he had priors. He, in fact, did not have priors when we checked. He went on to say that's why he didn't run. His cousin did. That's why he didn't run like his cousin did. He said that's why when the lady cop called him, that he and told him to sit on the ground, he walked right up to her. He said he thought he could explain what happened. We took the $60 from the black suspect. Okay. And then what I was going to write, because I didn't finish it, was we took the $60 from the black suspect and we entered it into evidence. Now, they did take the $60 from Marcello when he was searched. They wrote it into evidence and then they quickly gave it to the guy, one of the white guys, because they said that they were robbed of it. So they took Marcello's $60 and gave it to them. They also, to continue on, because I didn't get to write that, they quickly gave, once it was over, they allege that suspect one, the racially ambiguous cousin, had got away. That I do not believe happened at all. I believe he was arrested and just questioned as well. But because that confidential information, I believe he was let go either probably that night or soon after, because he did not stand trial with Marcello. And during Marcello's trial, they maintained that they never caught him. They didn't catch him in the helicopter overhead. The dogs didn't catch him. The police chasing him didn't catch him. Nobody could catch him. He was a freaking a track star. He got away, which was a lie just to explain him away from not being present. Okay. And then they had to grant him that to get that confidential information. So, so he either was arrested or just questioned. I don't know how that played out. Marcello was arrested and taken to 33rd Street Jail. But actually, in the records, it don't look like he was arrested until the next day. So I don't know if he was under arrest and they took him, or if they just, you know, they did arrest him, read him his rights, and then took him. But the date doesn't line up with when they booked him. So I don't know. I don't understand that. That's probably need to research more on that. The two guys as well, instead of being arrested and detained, which all four of them should have been detained in this situation. Because if you're a cop, you attempt to innocently pull somebody over. They don't pull over. They flee fled the scene. Okay, it don't later for whatever they saying, later for whatever anybody in that car is saying, we got to handle this through investigation. We don't know what happened. I can't take your word for what happened. I understand they couldn't take Marcello's word that he had nothing to do with it, that he just got in the car. They couldn't take his word. But they also shouldn't have taken the word of the two guys saying that they were robbed. What they should have did, and also they gave the car back. That car is now evidence. So now you tampered with that evidence. How you, we were robbed, and just give them their car, give the $60 that was taken from Marcello, because you said that Marcello took 80 from you, but now he has 60. So you take that 60, enter it into evidence, and then run it back to these guys. These guys take the car and head back to the club that they claimed they were going home from. See, if you don't understand what I'm saying now, you're really probably most likely going to have to go back through some of the other videos, because I'm just linking from one to the next video. So to understand what's happening, I need for you to watch the previous video. So watch it in a series. That's why I put it in the playlist. It goes through C murder case, and I'm going to get back to researching some more of his case. But right now, I just wanted to, when I find topics that really relate to Marcello's case, I've been putting that out. So now I got to get back to researching that other case to see what's going on with that. But yeah, so that's how it should have played out. To be honest, all four of them should have been arrested. They should not have tampered with any evidence. They should have dusted everything. They should have done a crime scene. They should have done a canvas. They should have questioned that bartender. Did you really give these guys this money to borrow? They should have questioned me. I should have been questioned, because later it comes up that somebody claims to have been with him, and he confessed to them that he was about to go out and rob somebody. That I know was a lie from the pits of jail, because he was not with that person during the same times this person wrote a written statement that he was with them, confessing he was with me. We asked, can that person be called to court to testify? We were told no, they could not. But behind our backs, they turned around and took that person's sworn written affidavit and did not even present it during court. After Marcello lost trial, I was served that sworn affidavit written by that person, saying that Marcello confessed that he was about to go rob somebody during the same time frames that he was with me, not with that person. That person lies and said that they spent the evening braiding Marcello's dreads back. And that's a complete lie as well, because that's how I spent my day with Marcello, braiding his hair. Then we went to the movies and we went to Point Orlando. So how did this person, this witness they got, that can't be called to court to be cross-examined, but can give a written statement? They said the reason they can't be called to court because they were not credible, but you took their written statement, so they were credible enough to write some fictional nonsense, but not credible enough to come to court. And I should have been called to court to dispute that, because I know he was not with that person at all. nowhere near that person. He was with me. I braided his hair down. And that also makes me wonder how they recognized him as a black guy with dreads. Because baby, his hair was braided back. How the heck you recognize him as a black guy with dreads? Remember, they only could ID one guy. They could not ID that driver. How did you ID him as a black guy with dreads, with his dreads braided down? And when I would braid Marcello's dreads down, he had a stocking cap he would put on, and then he would put on one of them beanies right over the top of it. So how you knew he had dreads? Then they also, I got one more segment to do about the police's falsifications, because in the end, three of them were called to court, and all three, and y'all remember the person that wrote the sworn affidavit, he and four others were in another crime, not too far after that, I think maybe 5 years later, where the guy, suspect, was on the ground. They said he was doing this, he was doing that. He was trying to evade them. They shot. He was on the ground. But somehow he was able to pick his arm up and try to, they said they thought he was going to shoot at them. So they powed him 49 more times. And when asked, okay, that's over outing. You don't need to, he was already on the ground. They all had their different stories. So that next segment is going to show how they've conflicted with their own selves. How they lied to conflict with their own selves. They weren't even making any sense. One was saying this, one was saying that. One said Marcello ran. One said he didn't. One said he did. One said that... It was so much. It was a lot. And then they all could recognize Marcello, ID him, but they could not recognize and ID the second guy. How? Why? When I probably, out of Marcello and the second guy, I probably would have remembered him more. Because like I said, he was so high yellow. Like, anyways, that's money calling. I'm probably going to have to get back to it. I got one more last thought. So, another thing that they also did wrong. Actually, I probably just need to finish writing and expanding on this, because I really liked the way that I wrote this, the way that it should have played out. But yeah, hashtag free Marcello. Please, he has done enough time. If you think he's guilty, he's done 21 years now. What crime is worth 21 years? What crime is worth more than 21 years? It's not a robbery, attempted robbery of $60. That's not worth 21 years. Most max that should have been was 10 years, and that was a 10-year charge. All them charges they stacked up against Marcello's were 10 years. What escalated it to 40 was them attaching a weapon to it. A weapon that they did not find. They said it was there because the guy said he had cold steel against my nose. So you again are just taking the suspects to, and they're actually suspects. You're taking their word as bond. And now you've tied a weapon into this case, which was able to escalate the charge 4 times. So had they literally did things the way they're supposed to, because they're here to protect, to serve, to uphold the law, not to bend and break and manipulate the law. All right, guys, I'm gonna call money back. Talk to y'all later. It's your girl, Cadillac.